The next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 3731 in the name of Fulton MacGregor on Apprenticeship Week. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. Can I ask those members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now? I call on Fulton MacGregor to open the debate. Mr MacGregor, 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I firstly thank all members who supported this motion and those who have stayed to take part today. And can I also welcome Skills Development Scotland to the public gallery for today's debate. Apprentice Week is next week, and all members will have been invited to a local organisation involved with Skills Development Scotland. I am looking forward personally to visiting the Simon Community Scotland in Coatbridge, a fantastic organisation which I've had some involvement with before, who are working to eradicate homelessness. And I encourage any member who hasn't already arranged a visit to get in touch with Skills Development Scotland and to get involved. I think everyone is in agreement that apprenticeships are a vital part of supporting our young people into work, and the extra investment and focus over the past decade has transformed apprenticeships across the board. Countries with well-developed vocational learning systems and significant employer engagement have the lowest levels of youth unemployment, so we're heading in the right direction by investing in modern apprenticeships. It's also good that we are providing more opportunities for young people who feel that college or university is not for them. Presiding Officer, while it is welcome that more apprenticeships are available, I think focus must now be put on ensuring that more young people from their BEM communities are also encouraged to sign up. As colleagues may be aware, I am the convener of the cross-party group on racial equality, and at our most recent meeting there was a lot of discussion among members there about the lack of access to apprenticeships for black and ethnic minority young people. Apprenticeships are a vital part of building a stronger Scotland, ensuring that we have a talented, multi-skilled workforce that will help build our economy. It is in all of our interest to ensure that these modern apprenticeships are easily and equally accessible to all of Scotland's young people. At the moment, BEM people in our society face many challenges in obtaining modern apprenticeships. The Coalition of Racial Equality and Rights carried out research into this area that shows that young BEM people are 6 times less likely to undertake a modern apprenticeship compared to young white people. That expands to 9 times less likely when looking specifically at Asian and African Caribbean and black young people. I am delighted that Skills Development Scotland have therefore launched an action plan to encourage more BEM young people into modern apprenticeships. The plan proposes to expand the range of career opportunities and increase the number of modern apprenticeships available to BEM people. Presiding Officer, to achieve this, Scotland must improve the capacity within employer networks to embrace positive action and recruitment practices. There must be an effort to increase engagement with the female BEM community, involving more young BEM women in apprenticeships. Trading providers must be able to identify good practice and be better prepared to recruit and support BEM young people on SDS programmes. The Quality Action Plan ensures the number of individuals from minority ethnic backgrounds who are apprentices will increase equal to the population share by 2021. I believe this action plan will show BME young people in building successful futures and will contribute to the businesses across Scotland. Presiding Officer, another area in which there must be more done is ensuring access to apprenticeships for young people who have been in care. And of course, this links in well with the government's review of the looked after and accommodated system. When I met with Skills Development Scotland last week, I was very pleased to hear that they are committed to ensuring support is in place to help care leavers into modern apprenticeships. And this includes, for example, by extending the age limit for care leavers to 29. Presiding Officer, the theme of the Awareness Week is Apprenticeships Are Changing, and aims to highlight the work being done to adapt apprenticeships to modern times. I was interested to learn a little about the new foundation apprenticeships and graduate apprenticeships being introduced. Foundation apprenticeships I find to be a very exciting prospect, as it engages young people while they are still at school and allows them to pick up valuable experience before the time comes when they need to find a job. We all know young people, whether they have gone to university or not, struggle to get into work due to a lack of experience. Well, I think that this sets out to avoid that, and at the end of the 2-year programme, we'll leave the young apprentice with a qualification which is the equivalent of a hire. I believe that some universities are now beginning to routinely accept these foundation apprenticeships as part of their entry criteria, and I would encourage more to get on board with that. Foundation apprenticeships are now available in every local authority area in Scotland, including, I am pleased to say, at New College Lanarkshire Coatbridge campus in my constituency, and it's hoped that by 2019 there will be 1,500 young people going through a foundation apprenticeship. Overall, presiding officer, there are currently 37,000 young people going through an apprenticeship in Scotland at foundation, modern or graduate level. It's important that we continue to recognise those who excel during these apprenticeships, and I wanted to briefly mention Daniel Barr from Coatbridge, who was recently awarded Adult Apprentice of the Year for his fantastic work as a plasterer. And I wanted to put on record my congratulations to him. As we are all aware, a new apprenticeship levy is being introduced in large employers from next month, and I was pleased that after full consultation, the Minister made key commitments, including increasing the planned number of graduate apprentices in 2017, considering raising the age limits for modern apprenticeships and a commitment to 30,000 new modern apprentices each year by 2020. Presiding officer, the aim of the Apprenticeship Week, which is to raise awareness and encourage more employers in Scotland to recruit apprentices. I think that this is something that we can all support, and I'm grateful to have had the opportunity to bring the subject to the Chamber today. And briefly, Presiding Officer, if you wouldn't mind, before I finish, I would like to put on record here in the Chamber today that it is my son's third birthday today, and I want to wish him...
He's not having an apprenticeship scheme,
He's not old enough yet, but I would like to do the honour of saying happy birthday in the Chamber here. Thanks very much.
We'll forgive you. Can I call Dean Lockhart, please, to be followed by Graham Dean. Mr Lockhart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I would also wish a very happy birthday to Fulton MacGregor's son. And I congratulate Fulton MacGregor on bringing this important debate to the Chamber. The debate this afternoon is an opportunity to promote Scottish Apprenticeship Week, which takes place next week, and to celebrate the success of Scotland's apprentices. As the motion suggests, it would indeed be a good show of support if members could take time to visit an apprentice, an apprenticeship employer or training provider in their constituency or region. On my part, this will include meeting up with my nephew, who is currently in an apprenticeship training programme to become an electrician. This is something he very much enjoys. A sparky, yes. I also congratulate Skills Development Scotland on its continued work to deliver Scotland's apprenticeship programmes, and also applaud the network of local authorities, third sector providers and colleges who work to support the many thousands of apprenticeships across the country. This coming week provides an opportunity to celebrate the achievements of all involved in delivering the programmes. It also provides a chance to reflect on how the changing nature of apprenticeships and how we in Scotland can ensure that we create a modern apprenticeship programme which is fit for employers and employees and takes into account the changing nature of employment going forward. Plans to increase apprenticeships featured in all parties' manifestos at the election last year, and I think this illustrates the cross-party support for the benefits that apprenticeships and work-based learning can bring to employers and businesses. There are differences in the policies of different parties as to how to deliver an increasing number of apprenticeships, but there is consensus about the priority of the objective. Apprenticeships are an effective way to support people, young people, and other people of many different ages into the workplace and to develop careers which then go on to meet future economic needs and to address the skills gap. In addition, at a time of fast-moving change in the economy and changing skills required, apprenticeships can provide the tools for lifelong learning and for adaptability to changing employment markets as well as changing technology. As the World Economic Forum highlights, for children currently at school, some 60% of the future jobs they will have do not currently exist. So having that ability for long life learning and training, it will be essential for the economy. In my own region of Stirling, Skills Development Scotland has provided data which shows that in 2016, there were 581 apprentices currently in training, with 291 modern apprenticeships starting last year, all of which is to be welcomed. In the Stirling area, construction is the most popular modern apprenticeship framework, representing 20% of the uptake. However, computing and IT modern apprenticeship represents only 6% of all modern apprenticeships in the Stirling area, and this may result in a longer-term shortage of skills in this particular area. This would be an area worth further investigation, given cross-party support for increasing skills in this important area. There are also well-documented imbalances between genders in certain sectors, with the uptake in the construction industry in Stirling, for example, being heavily gender-segregated, with 99% of apprenticeships being undertaken by men. There is also a demand for apprenticeships for older workers, which currently are not as available or are funded at lower rates. As employers such as ASDA have highlighted, it is important, therefore, that we see greater flexibility in terms of the age limit on apprenticeships. And also, I recognise the issue raised by Fulton MacGregor about the low ratio of young people from a BAME background in apprenticeships. Given these issues, it is vital that we all work together to evaluate where we can improve access to the modern apprenticeship programme, because as today's motion correctly notes, apprentices add a great deal of value to Scotland's economy and the skills of the workforce. This was made clear by the wealth of talent we saw being honoured last year at the Scottish Apprenticeships Award in November. Let me conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, to once again thank Fulton MacGregor for bringing this members' debate to the Chamber today, and I would encourage everyone to get involved in the many events taking place next week to celebrate Scottish Apprenticeship Week. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Lockhart. Call Graeme Day to be followed by Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin by firstly thanking Fulton MacGregor for bringing this debate to the Chamber. Scottish Apprenticeship Week provides an opportunity to highlight the huge benefits of people having the ability to work and earn while studying, and ultimately, in many cases, securing a skill set there will always be a demand for. Of course, university, college, or entering the workplace are right for some, but an apprenticeship will provide the ideal solution for others, and I very much welcome there being this range of choices on offer to our young people. Last year, two young men from my constituency were recognised for successfully embracing the benefits of an apprenticeship. Callum Lowe, who started working at Invermark Estate in 2015, was named the Scottish Gamekeepers Association Young Gamekeeper of the Year. He manages grouse, deer stalking and other resident wildlife on the 55,000-acre mixed sporting estate. Callum was also named Student Gamekeeper of the Year in 2014 and Lantra's Apprentice of the Year and Learner of the Year in 2015. Sean Davis was named Apprentice of the Year at the Trade Awards last year. Sean, an apprentice bricklayer with Stuart Milne Homes, was recognised for being the best in his class when he was at college and for, and I quote, unwavering motivation and ambition to hone skills in the trade and for his unparalleled work ethic, as well as his ability to learn fast and his attention to detail. Presiding Officer, as you know, I'm always not one to pass up an opportunity to highlight success stories from my constituency. But today I also want to focus on the provision of a safety net for when things, as they sometimes do, go wrong. Not through anything an apprentice may have done, but when an employer perhaps goes into administration. In 2014, that was the fate that befell John M. Henderson, an engineering firm in Arbroath, with 16 apprentices being told they were to lose their job, 8 of whom had started that apprenticeship just 11 weeks earlier. It was a devastating experience, not only for the young people concerned, but their wider families. I know because as a constituency MSP, I was contacted by a number of them and was actively involved in securing a solution. Thanks to the Scottish Government's Adopt an Apprentice scheme and a terrific local rally round, those who were in the second year or later stages of their apprenticeships ultimately didn't have too much trouble finding other employment. If memory serves, all bar one continued their apprenticeship elsewhere, the exception being a lad who decided to change career paths. And let me acknowledge the fantastic contributions made to that rally round by the Angus Training Group, Angus Council and the local PACE team. But let's also recognise that firms who took on those apprentices were able to receive support from the Adopt an Apprentice scheme, which offers financial incentives of £5,000 to the oil and gas sector and £2,000 for all other industries to take on an apprentice who's been let go to help with wage costs. The big challenge around the Henderson apprentices was finding work for those 8 lads, 5 in the care of the training group and 3 at Angus College, who'd barely embarked upon their first year. And that's where the training group really stepped up to the mark, committing at a potential cost of up to £18,000 to assuming responsibility for their new starts, guaranteeing them the completion of the first year of their apprenticeship, the training, regardless of whether employers were found or not. Angus Council also stepped up to the mark, supporting the training group via its Towards Employment scheme with wages and travel costs for 12 weeks or until employment was found, so that the apprentices were in a position to continue with their training. Ultimately, 2 of the 5 found other employers, 1 went to college. The money that Angus Council provided meant that those remaining apprentices could be kept on for over 30 weeks, the rest of their full training, before finding employment. Presiding Officer, I relate this tale not to introduce a negative note, but to highlight during this apprenticeship week that it isn't always plain sailing, and between the various bodies and the government, there was and is, when required, that safety net available that I touched upon earlier. And let me conclude by taking the opportunity provided by apprenticeship week and this debate to pay tribute to Alan Swankey, the MD of the training group, who's to retire shortly. Alan stepping down after 39 years. In that time, more than 1,600 apprentices have passed through the group's doors. Young men and women who, with that grounding, have gone to make careers for themselves in the engineering sector. That's quite a career achievement for Alan and a testimony to the work done by this highly regarded training provider. Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Day. I call Richard Leonard to be followed by Alison Johnson. Mr. Leonard.
Thanks, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank Fulton MacGregor for bringing this debate to Parliament this afternoon. Like many members, I will be supporting Apprenticeship Week, which begins on Monday with workplace visits and briefings with Skills Development Scotland. Apprenticeships are an essential part of the labour market where government intervention is both welcome and necessary. It is right that we do not leave the labour market to market forces alone, but that we plan it. Skills Development Scotland spends around £30 million a year in the area that I represent to support the skills agenda, backing over 6,000 apprentices in training, half of those on modern apprenticeships. And the Glasgow City Region Economic Action Plan, which is the action plan for the city deal, promises every 16 to 24-year-old a job, training or an apprenticeship, a right to work in effect. And with youth unemployment in Scotland about twice the national average of other age groups at 9%, according to Spice, this represents a bold commitment which could transform the lives of a whole generation of young people. It is an example, I would suggest, of the difference that Labour in power in local government can make. We live in topsy-turvy political times. Last year, when the details of the apprenticeship levy were announced by the Conservative government, the Conservative spokesperson in this parliament declared, "We now have the chance to invest in Scotland's workers." The SNP government minister, who's sitting here this afternoon, said in his press release, "This is an unnecessary financial burden for employers." For our part, the concerns across the Labour movement are around a concern that the new levy, which will be introduced in just a few days' time, could put downward pressure on wages and serve as a financial disincentive to employers to directly employ workers, as employers just below the £3 million pay bill threshold seek to avoid the levy altogether, and those above it try and keep their pay bill static or even cut it in order to minimise their liability under the levy. That is why, as... Yes, I will do, yes.
Minister?
I think he makes an eminently sensible point, incidentally, in terms of the disincentive that he has identified. Would he also join with me in recognising that it also introduces, where I spoke of the burden on employers, of course it introduces a £73 million tax burden on the public sector, removing investment in the public sector?
Mr. Leonard.
Yes, I agree. It was presented as an additional benefit to Scotland, but actually when you look at the liability on public sector employers, it leaves a hole in public finances. But I want to turn my attention in the minutes I've got to talk about the Scottish Government's approach, which is to go for an employer leadership model, setting up a Scottish Apprenticeship Advisory Board. I hope that the Scottish Government will listen to employee leadership as well. Because if the government simply provides for employer domination of the design and quality of Scotland's apprenticeships, they will be tailored solely to meet the ends of employers, not to meet the needs of working people and young working people in particular. And I say, therefore, to the Minister this afternoon, establishing a Scottish Government Apprenticeship Framework Standards Group with only one trade union representative out of 21 members is not good enough. Forming a Scottish Apprenticeship Employer Equalities Group with one trade union representative out of 23 is not good enough either. Setting up a Scottish Apprenticeship Employer Engagement Group with nobody from the trade union movement on it is bluntly unacceptable. And creating a main advisory board directing these groups with one trade union representative on it out of 28 members, by any measure, in plain and simple terms, is neither democratic nor representative. In fact, there are as many voices from employers caught up in the construction industry blacklisting scandal on the Scottish Government's Advisory Board on Apprentices as there are trade union voices. I am sure that was not the result the Minister set out to achieve, but that is the result we have got, and so he should act to correct it. Finally, I've been impressed in my own work with Skills Development Scotland in how they are targeting young people who have come through the care system. who have come who are going through the community justice system. We should be demanding equality for these young people and for all those others whose access to the labour market is subject to barriers. This is where I hope we can redouble our efforts this year, building on the focus which Apprenticeship Week provides to boost not just the quantity of Scotland's apprenticeships, but as this motion suggests, just as importantly, to boost their quality and their equality too.
Thank you, Mr. Leonard. I call Alison Johnson to be followed by David Torrance. Ms. Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and to Fulton MacGregor for bringing this debate. I'm certainly glad it's not about a certain TV show and its hosts. What this week is about is promoting apprenticeships as an important and rewarding career path and celebrating businesses who value training up their staff. And I hope it's also about challenging stereotypes, but it has occurred to me that we're not exactly gender balanced in this debate today. During my time as a councillor in Edinburgh and as an MSP for the Lothian region, I've met apprentices and employers who've taken on apprentices, and their experience of apprenticeship has been overwhelmingly positive, and I would encourage anyone in school to consider it as a career option. The Wood Commission reported a few years ago, and there was an absolute insistence on parity of esteem. And I think it really is high time we challenge this notion that vocational apprentices, that career path is in any way inferior to that of higher education. In Edinburgh in 2016-17, there were over 1,000 modern apprenticeship starts. So young people won't be alone in taking up this positive path. Next week, we'll see Edinburgh host a roadshow for S4 to S6. And for anyone up to 24 years old, it'll be an open day where you'll learn about apprenticeships. There'll be events for parents, careers advisors and teachers, and a graduation event for those who completed their training last year. And I really would encourage those who can to get along. Last year, I had the privilege of awarding prizes won by construction apprentices in this building. It was an incredibly moving afternoon, and I heard from one young man, his tale will always stick in my mind. He had a cycle to work on, a pink bicycle, and that always sticks in my mind because, to be honest, he couldn't afford the transport costs on his wage. Now, the Green Manifesto, in which I stood for election, highlighted the importance of paying apprenticeships at least the living wage, regardless of age. The national minimum wage for apprentices remains incredibly low, £3.40 an hour, rising to £3.50 from April this year, less than half the minimum wage and a far cry from a living one. And the majority of apprentices are paid more than this minimum, but if we want to really value vocational jobs and reward that with fair pay, the UK government needs to raise the statutory minimum, and we should add our voices to that call. Edinburgh has a successful scheme called the Edinburgh Guarantee to offer a job, training or education to every school leaver. There's a similar national ambition, but we know that 8% of school leavers left without a job, training or further education, and that this rises to 15% among school leavers from the most disadvantaged areas. Apprenticeship Week may be able to give more opportunities to these young people. And I do think that we need to do more to reduce gender stereotypes and increase ethnic minority participation. And I welcome Fulton MacGregor's focus on that and other colleagues too. I don't think anyone in this debate will disagree. The question is how we tackle this challenge. The organisation Close the Gap have created a tool based on a work by the Women in Scotland's Economy Research Centre and applied it to the Scottish Modern Apprenticeship Programme. And some of the ideas that came forward were taster sessions for women in non-traditional career paths, still far too few involved in construction, financial incentives for employers recruiting women in non-traditional careers, more women-only pre-vocational training courses, and same-sex mentors. Another idea with potential included having 2 work experience placements at school, one for a pupil's first choice location and a second in a non-traditional industry. Before we even look at the concentration of women in service roles traditionally paid less, the most recent SDS stats show that 63% of MA starts were male, 37% female, 1.7% from ethnic minority backgrounds. So I welcome the government's ambitions to do more and plans like SDS's Equality Action Plan and Fund to give support to employers to take on modern apprentices from more diverse backgrounds. And I hope Apprenticeship Week strapline that apprenticeships are changing can ring true for improvements in gender, pay and parity of esteem. Presiding officer, in closing, none of this should take away from my experience that apprenticeships are already an excellent career path for many, and I'd encourage any young person to go along to an event near you and consider this. Thank you.
Thank you very much. David Torrance, followed by Bill Bowman. Mr. Torrance, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to congratulate Fulton MacGregor for securing this debate in Parliament today to celebrate Apprenticeship Week 2017 and the positive contribution apprenticeships have made on our society, whether on individuals, businesses, government or the wider Scottish economy. I would encourage everyone to participate in events being held across Scotland to support and bring awareness to all of the amazing opportunities that apprenticeships provide. The theme of Apprenticeship Week 2017 is Apprenticeships Are Changing. Each year, we set an extremely ambitious target to create new opportunities. By 2020, the Scottish Government aims to expand the number of modern apprenticeships opportunities to 30,000 new starts each year, while simultaneously improving the induction of new standards to ensure that those seeking apprenticeships can rise to the top and reach their full potential. Even more young people will be able to enter a workforce ranging from employees such as BT, Microsoft, Scottish Power, Royal Air Force, Boots, British Airways, BBC Scotland, Santander and Lloyds Bank Group, just to name a few. Small and local businesses have also pledged new apprenticeships and traineeships to give young people the opportunity to develop skills, languages, maths, social sciences to progress to other jobs and open other prospects. In my own constituency, a wide array of apprenticeships are available and are specially catered to the skills that young people seek to develop and the goals they want to achieve. I was particularly impressed during a visit to Harry Fairbairn, BMW Cardealship in Kirkcaldy, where I met and spoke to staff and young apprentices. The automotive and mechanical industry is a highly skilled field, and I was amazed by not only the opportunities available, but the high standard of education and skill received by apprenticeships. Fife Council and Fife College are some of the area's largest apprentice employers, and offers modern apprenticeships ranging from engineering, construction, social services, and creative and media studies. A combination of learning and working provides young people with the best of both worlds, hands-on work experience as well as studying. The 30,000 yearly pledge of apprenticeship is a testament to the popularity of these apprenticeships, as more and more young people, employers, parents and teachers recognise the benefits that apprenticeships and work-based learning brings economic and social investment into our economy that will certainly trickle down to our local communities. It's crucial to recognise how businesses and young people can help each other through apprenticeships. When a young person gets involved with a business as an apprentice, they receive the confidence and qualifications they need to succeed in the future. The businesses are able to build talent, productivity and motivation that is crucial for growth, success and accomplishment. The opportunities that apprenticeships provide deliver life-changing opportunities not only for young people, but also for helping businesses who are eligible for grants by taking on an apprentice. Skills Development Scotland, Scotland's national skills body, plays a crucial part in helping to create a skilled workforce that is prepared to face the future by setting up young people up for success in their careers. Crucially, SDS is designed to tackle potential skills gaps, as well as supporting existing apprenticeships to develop their skills. There are still challenges that young people entering the workforce face today. For example, many young women are facing challenges that make apprenticeships opportunities less attractive option rather than further education. It is our job as policymakers to close the gender gap and ensure that every sector of our economy provides as many opportunities to women as it does to men. An apprenticeship is a real success story. Modern apprenticeship employs over 30,000 young people. 91% of apprentices remain in employment 6 months after completing their modern apprenticeship. And 96% of employers believe their former apprentices are often better equipped to carry on out their jobs. Consistent with this year's theme, which highlights the changing nature of apprenticeships, SDS has introduced new programmes such as the Foundation Apprenticeship, which brings education closer to industry, as well as a graduate-level apprenticeship, which takes work-based learning up to a master's degree level. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I encourage all my fellow MSPs to get involved with as many events as possible in their respective areas during Apprenticeship Week to show support to our country's future workforce. Growing talent amongst the next generation and aiding young people to develop skills to transition into new careers through apprenticeships is a positive way of laying a strong foundation for economic and social improvements.
Thank you very much, Ms. Torrance. And I know you looked up at the clock, so we're making progress. I call Bill Bowman. Mr. Bowman will be the last speaker in the open debate.
Okay, thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to participate in this afternoon's debate on Apprenticeship Week and join colleagues in congratulating Fulton MacGregor on bringing it forward. And in the spirit of the earlier speakers, can I wish everybody just happy Thursday, since I don't have a specific opportunity. Like many members across the chamber, I'm looking forward to participate in Scottish Apprenticeship Week next week. I'm going to be visiting two Dundee-based employers, Caledonia Housing Association and Rosango House Nursery, who between them employ 9 apprentices. These young people employed by both of these employers will benefit from the opportunity to build their confidence, learn something new and develop their skill set. And I think the confidence that the earlier member mentioned is an important aspect of this as well. These are all attributes that will stand them in good stead when they embark on their chosen career path and apply for jobs. I was pleased to note that in a survey by Skills Development Scotland that in 2016, two-thirds of modern apprentices who they surveyed were still employed with their original employer. In such a competitive job market as the one that exists today, any experience that young people can get in the world of work is good experience. Moreover, that experience is not only for those young people who complete their apprenticeships. The companies that employ them benefit from having someone with a willingness to learn and the ability to create a training program for their apprentices that best meets the need of their business. And as the motion states, our country's workforce benefits. In my previous employment, it was one of the pleasures of my job to witness the progress that young trainee accountants who joined our firm made as they worked their way up the ladder, while at the same time following a program of professional development. In our manifesto last year, the Scottish Conservatives made 3 commitments in the skills portfolio: to create new skills academies, expand the number of apprenticeship starts, and provide a more bite-sized training opportunities. And we believe that the proceeds from the apprenticeship levy, which comes into force in April this year, should advance all 3 of these objectives. While we will always welcome the creation of new and more apprenticeships, it is important to recognise that employer-delivered apprenticeships or training programmes are able to deliver the same standard of training without the additional benefit of government support, something that a number of businesses have contacted me about and I hope the Minister will consider. Scottish Apprenticeships Week is about celebrating and promoting the benefits that apprenticeships bring to individuals, businesses and the economy. And as others have encouraged, I think the more of us that can get out and see this on the ground, the better. It's one thing to listen and to read about, but when you actually see it in place, you see the benefit that it's doing. Apprenticeships are often the best route for those young people who do not consider university to be the right choice for them, but who would benefit more from going straight into the workplace, learning on the job and working towards an industry-recognised qualification. Presiding Officer, I look forward to meeting apprenticeships during my visits next week and talking to them about their own experiences. We have a duty to do everything we can to support young people and give them the best opportunity to succeed. Whether through educational opportunities or vocational routes, it is important that the skill base of our workforce is matched to the needs of our economy now and in the future. I believe that apprenticeships play a vital part in equipping our young people with the skills and experiences required to do this. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I call on Janie Hepburn to wind up the Government Minister. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, President Officer. Can I say at the outset, I very much welcome the chance that we have had to debate next week's Scottish Apprenticeship Week. And in that regard, can I join with others in thanking Fulton MacGregor for having brought the subject matter to the Chamber. Can I also wish the young MacGregor, that's Fulton MacGregor's son rather than Fulton MacGregor himself, a very happy birthday. I think I heard you inquiring, President Officer, as to whether or not that was because Fulton MacGregor's son had begun an apprenticeship. I know there has been a call for the Scottish Government to embed a degree of age flexibility in terms of our approach to modern apprenticeships. I can confirm we do not intend to go quite that far, President Officer, but of course it's never too early to plan for a undertaking an apprenticeship. And Dean Lockhart misheard me when I did what we're always advised by yourself and the other presiding officers not to do, presiding officer, so I apologise for having done so, made a,
sedentary intervention. I think he thought I had said the Sparky when he was talking about his nephew undertaking his apprenticeship. I hadn't actually done that. I was inquiring as to whether it was his nephew's birthday. I didn't get any response. I can only assume not, but let me wish Dean Lockhart's nephew all the best as he takes forward his apprenticeship. I'm very proud, President Officer, that the range of apprenticeship opportunities we have offered over the years has been able to change many lives for the better. Over the last parliamentary session, we offered over 128,000 new modern apprenticeship starts supported by the Scottish Government. As a range of members, I think all members have made the point, a modern apprenticeship can be a life-changing opportunity for a person undertaking it. And David Torrance was quite correct to identify that not only does it provide that person to be in work, to have an industry recognised qualification to support their future career ambitions, but also builds a real sense of confidence in the person undertaking such an apprenticeship. And Graeme Day and I think Alison Johnson talked about us needing to put apprenticeships on an unequal footing with the pursuit of academia. I think she used the term parity of esteem. Graeme Day was making similar points. It is just as valid for a young person leaving the educational environment to undertake an apprenticeship as it is to move on to undertake the pursuit of further education or higher education study. And I think that should be a core message we take forward from this debate. It's something we're trying to make very clear in the school environment through our entire developing the young workforce agenda. And it's, I think, well worth us putting on the record, having had this type of debate here in Scotland's national legislature, allows us to recognise the equal validity of undertaking apprenticeship as with going on to academic pursuits. And indeed, Apprenticeship Week itself is an opportunity to promote such as well, to try and dispel some of the misconceptions that have existed, I think are less that have existed, that suggest that an apprenticeship is not as valuable as the pursuit of academic study. I'll be undertaking visits each and every day next week. All Scottish Government ministers will be undertaking at least one visit associated with Scottish Apprenticeship Week, as has been mentioned by, I think, every member in this debate. All MSPs can do so. It's perhaps not surprising that given we are the select few taking part in this debate that all of us intend to undertake such a visit, but I'm sure we're all encourage colleagues to get involved in that activity too. Richard Leonard was quite correct. We cannot just leave it to the market alone to determine whether or how we take forward our apprenticeships. We certainly need to respond to economic and social demand. We certainly need employers across all sectors, not just the private sector, the public sector, indeed the third sector, to be involved in delivery. But there is a critical role for government intervention. There were some concerns raised by Mr. Leonard about the role of trade unions. I'll certainly, if he wants to contact me, I'd be happy to reflect on any specific concerns he has, but I would want to reassure him and all members across this chamber that I take very seriously the need to engage with trade unions, the Scottish Trade Union Congress, around this matter, indeed all matters related to my portfolio. And I can tell him my officials were engaging directly with the SDUC just last week in relation to how we as an administration have responded to the apprenticeship levy, and they were very supportive of the approach that we are taking. And having mentioned the levy, I have to say it was somewhat surprising to me that it was left to Mr. Leonard to raise the levy. I think thus far, hitherto, it's been Conservative Speaker after Conservative Speaker who have raised the issue around the apprenticeship levy with me thus far. I think the penny must finally be dropping with Conservative members, given they didn't raise it today. I think they are now beginning to recognise that the wool was being pulled over the eyes of many people by the implementation of this new fiscal measure by the UK government. Of course, doesn't bring forward pockets of new funding for disbursement for activity related to apprenticeships and employability and training. It essentially replaces existing funding, and I quite genuinely think that many members in the Conservative bench here didn't quite realise and recognise that at first. Of course, many people, I think all of us now, recognise that as the case. But I mentioned the levy because what we did in response to the imposition of that levy by the UK government was what the UK government didn't do. We went out and undertook a public consultation in relation to the levy, and that has been hugely instructive in determining how we take forward our further offering of the delivery of apprenticeships. We are undertaking implementation of all of what we found and gathered through the consultation that we undertook. That's why we are rolling out our ambition to have 30,000 more apprenticeship starts by the year 2020, which is what the consultation told us to do. That's why we're expanding the provision of foundation apprenticeships in the school environment. That's why we're expanding the provision of graduate apprenticeships. That's why we're implementing a flexible workforce development fund, which is something else that the consultation to, and if I've got time, I'll be delighted to give way to Mr. Lockhart.
Mr. Lockhart.
Much. I understand the rate of apprenticeships in Scotland is approximately one half of the rate of the rest of the UK. With you, the numbers you provided, when do you see equilibrium being reached in the sense of apprenticeship numbers in Scotland reaching the same ratio as the rest of the UK?
Minister.
I wondered when, that's the first time that's been raised with me in the chamber, President Officer, and I knew inevitably it would be, because what we, it isn't for me, incidentally, to worry about what the provision of apprenticeships might be in the rest of the UK, certainly not in England. That's for the UK government to worry about. I just wonder, with this massive expansion that they are planning to undertake to essentially have 600,000 starts each and every year going forward, I just wonder how that can possibly be delivered, because if you undertake the process of consultation, which we undertook, there was no demand to have a pro rata share of that level of delivery. So for me, we've got a very high quality modern apprenticeship offering here in Scotland. I think there's significant questions about the quality of apprenticeship that might be delivered south of the border. So I'll be happy to explore that further with Mr. Lockhart, but I suggest he looks a bit closer at what may be delivered in the rest of the UK. Let me just finish. I know I'm a bit over time now, President Officer, but you're always very generous to me in allowing me to make the relevant points that must be made and pick up on what members have said, because there were some issues raised.
I'm not too
about,
generous.
Oh, I've always found you to be remarkably generous, Presiding Officer.
Your time is getting shorter all the time.
In terms of the equalities agenda that members have raised, I recognise there is significant underrepresentation for certain sections of our society in our modern apprenticeship delivery. Undoubtedly, some of the barriers are structural. I think largely, though, they are, and I think Alison Johnson made this point, they're cultural, and that's not going to be readily overcome. But there is a significant desire to achieve the better spread and representation of modern apprentices across the country. We are implementing some changes to try and incentivise that through an enhanced payment for those who are disabled, for those who are care leavers. We're introducing a rural supplement for modern apprenticeships from next year to try and respond to some of these challenges, but we'll always be willing to consider what more we can do. And in that regard, Presiding Officer, let me just conclude by saying it's very welcome we've had this debate. I wish all the members who are going to undertake visits next week a very enjoyable set of visits, and it's absolutely appropriate that we've had this chance to recognise apprentices the length and breadth of Scotland who are undertaking fantastic work.
Thank you. That concludes the debate. I now suspend this meeting until 2:30.